Everybody's mad at police now. I watched that. You see that shit on Netflix? The making a murderer? The Stephen Avery story? Yeah, but if you haven't seen it, check it out. Is in more trouble than any white person in the history of the United States has ever been in. In a justice system designed for him to thrive, he's failed miserably twice. I can't even wrap my mind around it.
Plains as lovers do, we race beneath the summer sun. dusky eyes met his soul blue eyes, soaring spirits built as one. We blazed our love across the sky, surrendered to its ancient force. Until the day he said goodbye and climbed aboard the Iron Horse. Heard its challenge loud and shrill as we chested off the crazy ride. Though my steed had the stronger will, the Iron Horse had the longer stride. Whistle cut me like a blade, I loathed screaming, smoky cry. A pretty leave as any made our ride like wind and asking why. Astride my fearless painted done, I chose my pace and set my course. To catch this demon on the run, my steed against this iron horse. Heard its challenge loud and shrill as we chased it up the great divide. And though my steed had the stronger will, the iron horse had the longer stride. Through the thunder of its blare, I yelled my fury at the beast. Wasted words lost in the air as it roared its way forever east. The Iron Horse's speed.
If Making a Murder was about a black dude, that shit would be called Duh.
Holy crap, was that a Sasquatch?
Holy crap, was that a Hyundai?
Of course everything can go wrong. Seems like it didn't know. The motherfucker even had $200,000 for his legal defense. That should get you off in Wisconsin. That's like OJ.
I still think this is the craziest idea you've ever had, and that's really saying something.
Just give it time. This will work.
Prudence? We have an emergency?
Ruka, just go pee in the bushes. Just make sure it's not dirt.
What?
Okay. Bigfoot, you are in great danger. There are bad people coming here to kill you. You have to go to another forest. Please, please understand me. He doesn't understand. Okay, I hate to do this. Bigfoot, go away! I don't like you. You're ugly, you smell bad, and men with lots of body hair is a total turnoff. Now just go to some other forest and live your big stupid life. Just go away.
No,
just calm down. I don't think he means any harm.
Okay, so we'll go on three, okay?
Okay.
All right, here we go. One, two, three. Ah! Holy crap! Was that a Sasquatch? And scene.
I liked it.
Yeah, that's good.
That was simple.
Hey.
Hi, Catherine.
Hey.
So, have you seen my feet?
Yeah.
What do you think?
I don't know, they're
pretty big, huh?
Yeah, they're pretty big.
You know what they say about big feet?
Let's rehearse a little later.
We'll do it later.
Seriously. Come on, what do they say about big feet? Everybody always says it and laughs and they never tell me the answer. Oh, man!
All he needed to get off that he didn't have was a single black jury. That's all it would have took. Because only a black dude in the United States can look at 11 other dudes and be like, I think the police did this shit.
exciting. The waves are rising and rising. And when I get that feeling, I want the sensual healing. Sensual healing. It's good for me.
Are you afraid of grizzly bears?
Yeah, I'm afraid of grizzly bears. Are you afraid of grizzly bears?
No, I eat grizzly bears for breakfast.
Oh.
All right, low-fat vanilla chai latte.
Aw, I wanted mine with soy.
For Stephen Avery, convicted of killing Teresa Halbach, is offering a big reward in that case.
Amanda Quintana is here now with the latest on this story. Amanda?
Yes, we all know Avery was the subject of a popular Netflix documentary on his murder conviction in the murder of Halbach, a photographer in northeastern Wisconsin. Kathleen Zellner, Avery's attorney who specializes in wrongful conviction cases, tweeted a news release this morning announcing the $100,000 reward for the arrest and conviction of what she calls the real killer of Teresa Halbach.
Hey, Rebel, any special message for all the kids watching at home?
Stay out of trouble.
How can we help you, officer?
Dick Jones is wanted for murder.
This is absurd! That thing is a violent mechanical psychopath!
My program will not allow me to act against an officer of this company.
Serious charges. What is your evidence?
I'll buy that for a dollar. Murphy.
That's not an animal. That's my hat.
Oh, God. No.
Yeah, what is that music?
It was a squat.
Did she say anything about me?
Well, she said you're a disease-ridden, overgrown Neanderthal-like brute with some nasty, nasty breath.
So she likes me. All right, then.
All right, so I'm going to talk about the RAV4 today. There's always discussions whether or not there was one or two rad pours, and I get a bunch of different interesting things told to me all the time by viewers and people that follow the case. And there's so many different conflicting facts that it's hard to keep up with all of them. But this video isn't going to cover every single thing that's ever been discovered or said about the RAV, because I mean, just the research alone would be a nightmare trying to uncover every single thing that's ever been said about it, various facts and whatnot. But what I am going to talk about is I want to talk about the things that I see with the RAV as it pertains to both arguments. Okay, so I want to point out things for reasons why I think there was only one. I want to point out certain things for reasons why there might have been two. And personally, I'm in the middle, really, of both arguments. I think I'd lean more towards there being one RAV, but still close to the middle. And that's what we're going to talk about today, is just the different things that I see, arguments that can be made, and stuff like that.
Hey guys, what's up? Thank you for tuning in. You're listening to Live from the Woods. Playing for an entire hour. So enjoy yourself, relax, and get squatchy. You know what I want right now? I want some brown sugar. We'll be right back.
coaching the basketball team.
That's great.
You know, we had practice last night, so it was cool. Yeah, it was
that's
good.
Awesome.
I think we're gonna have a good team.
Wow. Yeah, but.
So, what are you, 3'2"?
I'm 5'7".
Oh.
Oh, this is great.
Hmm. You guys want one?
No, thanks.
I got a,
Oh, yeah, me too.
Oh, yeah, I get it. Get it, too.
So here we go. Now, one of the main people that constantly get on my case about the rap is Richard Boyd.
Now, you need to know the color of the door handle outside.
Now, I know a lot of you know who he is, and maybe some of you don't. I'm not conflicted with him one way or the other. He hasn't personally, you know, attacked me outside of a joking way.
Action 2 News at 10. Coverage you can count on.
How's it going, sir? How you doing?
Murphy, huh?
Yes, sir.
I got something for you.
All right, what you got?
You're a police officer, and you're investigating a crime that involved a vehicle, let's say.
Hey, check this shit out. Look what I found. Yeah. Check that out. There we go. There we go. That's what we're talking about. Huh? Hey, Steve. Yeah. Look what I found. Huh? All right, like me now, huh? Here it is. Steve and Avery, here's your RAV4. Yeah. You want me to buy this one? I'll buy this one. Yeah, we'll completely redo it, but here's the paint job. Check this paint job out. Look at that shit. Oh, look at that. It's a piece of crap. I can pick it up for $1,500. What do you think? You want this wrap for? Okay. Jack Vince, you. Oh, well. Anyway, there's your wrap for. There you go. That's it. Huh? There it is. Oh, look at this. Let's see. This is Mystic Teal. This is Mystic Teal. Fuck yeah. You can still see that emblem. Toyota. It's got a serial number right there. Look at that. See that? Yeah, it's etched right in the glass. This is in between the glass. Hey, I'm knocking on the son of a bitch. That's Mystic fucking Teal, people. That's not 805. That's Mystic Teal. Okay? See that? That's supposed to be the same color. It's not. It's black. See that? That's black. That's gray. And the other one was blue. You can't mistake the shit. Okay? You just can't mistake the shit. Anyway, there's a new RAV. There we have it, people. Huh? Hey, buy me about 5 RAV4s, Steve. Maybe, maybe not. I don't know what it is. We'll see. There you go. What do you want to know? Mystic Teal of me. See, look at that. Different coloration. That's the gray one. This is the black one. On Teresa's, the black one was green. Evidence photo, it's black. What's that? There's another RAV4. So anyway, there's your RAV4s, dude.
Alright. And they show you a list that's on the corner wall of that vehicle. Don't believe it. Call up and run that VIN through the parks department to see what color the cladding is supposed to be, what color the bumper is supposed to be, the hardware, door handle, mirror, you know, the differences. And you will find that in this particular case that you don't know about, this VIN is on the firewall of a 1999 Toyota RAV4, but this VIN is to a 760 color code.
Found these group of kids out in the middle of nowhere, and I was about to, you know, fall into the stereotype of terror and attacking. And but one of them offered me one of these, a cousin sub, and it changed my life. It made my day better. From here on out, I swear I will not eat another hiker or camper or stray dog again, because I don't need to. Thank you. Thank you. Cousins, thank you. I love you guys.
Step in your office, huh?
Yeah. Why not?
I want you to tell me if those two vehicles are the same paint job. Is that the same paint job?
No way. This top one right here is blue with black mirrors.
Yeah.
It looks like black doorknobs, door handles.
Yeah.
Looks like a black or gray trimming. And this one right here looks like it's all green. Everything's green on it. A dark green.
Yeah. So are they the same paint job?
No. Not even close.
A totally different paint job.
Totally.
Can this morph into that because you're looking at a certain angle? No. Or light conditions?
No.
Overcast?
You can see that there's a green tint to this one.
Okay. What about at night? Would it turn green at night?
No. There's no way.
There's no way you can confuse those two?
No. Totally two different colors.
$100,000 reward. Okay, here's what it is. It says for the conviction of the real killer of Teresa Halbach. Well, the question I have is, Stephen Avery was convicted on the blue vehicle with the gray trim and the black door handle. But Teresa was the green one, the all green one. So Stephen Avery's blood is in a vehicle that is not painted the same color as the one that Teresa had. So therefore it's a different vehicle. And if you get Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey out and there is no killer and the search resumes for Teresa Marie Halbach, who gets the $100,000?
Let's shut the camera off.
Okay.
That's what this bin goes back at. The door handles are supposed to be green. You know, same color as the vehicle, the bumpers, pretty much everything's green.
Okay.
Nothing's not green. But this bin, it's on a K95, which is a two-tone. It has unpainted bumpers, unpainted paneling, unpainted flares, and black door handles and black mirror.
Where's this vehicle at?
So, when you're involved in the case, remember to do that. And you might catch somebody forging this. Now, for $100,000 reward out there associated with this number, I have proven to you, I will prove to you, that this number does not belong stamped on that vehicle. And the question that you have to answer, I don't know how they did it, but there's the numbers and they're not matching, you see. You see that? How they're not, this has been put on there. This is not Toyota font, and it's on there pretty good, but not quite all the way.
Okay.
So this has been added to it. So how did they do that? Because it had, this is actually a 2, and this is a 1. This is supposed to be, but they have it a 3 and a 4. So these two numbers have been messed with.
Okay.
How they do that, I don't know. I have no clue. But they did it because there's the proof of it. Now, have you watched Making a Murderer on Netflix?
I haven't watched it. No.
Well, this is the vehicle to Making a Murderer. Stephen Avery, Brendan Dassey has been in prison for like 18 years apiece. And that bin is not, or that on that firewall does not correspond with the vehicle color code.
Okay.
That's it.
So if I take a photocopy of this, who can I send it off to?
Well, here's what it is. I need an email address, and then I will send you a video link, and then you can use that video link.
Okay.
All right, that's what I really need to do. Okay.
Yeah.
But you got a camera running right now, right?
I do. Yes, sir.
Okay, all this. Now, what I want to do is I want you to, two reasons why I'm coming to you. The first reason is in an investigation, police investigation, don't just take the numbers and say, well, that's the numbers.
Right.
You know, get down there and look at the numbers and make sure. And then call up, in this case, Toyota. Call up the parts department, have them run it, and see if everything matches. Because if it doesn't match on it, then boom, you busted them. See?
Okay.
Just by making a few phone calls. Now, had they made phone calls, these two guys wouldn't be in prison. And they would have had all the stuff. So,
what state are these guys in?
This is in Wisconsin. So but the lesson to be learned here is, from that is you need to put that in your guided manual or something. I don't know. But however you do that because it's an investigative tool. This particular technique that I have developed is an investigative tool.
Okay.
You guys can put that in your toolbox.
All right. I will pass that off to all my other officers.
Now, there's a $100,000 reward for information to the murderer of Teresa Marie Hallbaum. But that was a spontaneous, nobody knew about it, surprise. Well, not really. Because when you're getting down there and you're falsifying vehicles and bins, something else is going on. It's not spontaneous. So
something deliberate, something that was planned.
There's not a murder. Teresa Marie Hallbaum is not dead because you can't do that and say, well, Steve just blew up one day and just murdered her just on this, and nobody else is involved. Bullshit. Somebody else is involved. Right there is proof. So if you can, Cheney Police Department, you contact Kathleen T. Zellner and say, in our investigation, we found out that you got the wrong vehicle and you've had the wrong vehicle the whole time. You see?
Let me write that name down.
That's it. It'll be in the email.
Okay.
Just give me an email and you'll have it all.
All right. I will give you my work email right here.
Sure. The Cheney Police Department could possibly get $100,000 put into its treasury, however. Because the reward's out there. You're an entity. You know? And a person or an entity that solves the case gets the money, right?
Right. I don't know if we can... I don't know if we can as law enforcement, but you could. I mean, potentially, I don't know.
Well, I'm going to get a CAD on this, right?
Yeah, you want the CAD number?
Well, I got to have the CAD number. That's my receipt.
802, can I get the CAD number? I'll write it under the case number fire.
Sure. But the real big question is...
One sec. Right there.
The only thing that I can't answer is how did they do it? It's done. How did they do it? You see? And besides that, we've got information that the then listed to Teresa Hallbaum is not listed to Teresa Hallbaum. Hmm. Yeah, it's not her then, and they made up all this paperwork and stuff like that, and it's not true. You know, because her vehicle was dark green and this is a bright blue.
Okay.
She's so dark green. They say turquoise is actually blue, it's a toilet. You see? But her vehicle was dark green, which is a 6P3 deep jewel green. That's what she was.
Okay.
But it's not a color code combination, it's single. But here's the point, is somebody knew this. Somebody knew this. And they gave them the wrong vehicle, so they put that VIN on there not knowing about the color code. So somebody in Calumet County was trying to frame Stephen Avery, Manitowoc County was trying to prevent them from doing so. So they took her vehicle because they impounded it on the 3rd, and this was impounded on the 5th, and they charged these guys and they got convicted for murder on the vehicle they impounded on the 5th, when actually her vehicle was on the 4th in Manitowoc County. And this is in Calumet County. There's two RAV4s.
Right. So the picture here of that bin, did that come from the show? Is that the one they showed?
This is the one that that Stephen Avery Brindazzi was convicted on.
Okay.
This is fraudulent. And fraud on felon the court makes the conviction non and void. In addition to, they didn't have, because of the fraudulent, they didn't have jurisdiction, which is Federal Rule 60B4, which is void judgment. Void. So they walk out of prison. So what you're going to do, rightfully, okay, is free two guys from prison that shouldn't be there.
Dizzy, and that's what this is about.
All right. Well, let me grab a picture of that so I can take it with this camera here. It's all for me. Perfect.
This is the only one. I just had it made up and printed and come down to you, but...
Do you need these notes, though?
No.
Okay.
You do.
Okay, I'll keep it there.
But Steve Vogel down here, Otto, he doesn't know how they did it, and he's not going to get out there and say it because he's a business. Mm-hmm. He can't do that.
Right.
So the only other option, and all the other businesses are not going to sit there and say how you do that. So I need to know how they did that. The only people that know how they did that is them and you. Thus, I'm here. I don't know how they put those on there. But they're on there.
Sounds like I got some homework to do.
No.
Well, it sounds like you've done the homework. I'm just waiting on that email.
You're waiting on the email. That's right. Make your job easy.
All right, sir. So... I'll be waiting on that email, but it was nice to meet you, all right? I guess I gotta go watch that show now, too.
Making a Murder?
Yeah.
I'm part of the team, man.
There you go.
All right. So anyway, the reason why I'm here is I'm in the support and defense of the Constitution of the United States of America, the oath that I took. I didn't take it when I got out.
Right.
And I see a violation of the Constitution, and thus I bring it to you. When I was in the Navy, you take it up to your superior officer, and they take it up to headquarters. That's the reason why I don't take it to them.
Right.
Down there, I bring it to my local law enforcement. If I give you information about
to go up the chain. I get
something
it.
Else, then you're going to send it to them and say, hey, Cheney says you guys are... I'm on camera, so I'm okay. All right?
All right.
But I want you to write up a police response to a vehicle and the association with the VIN and how you double-checked the VIN.
Okay.
Versus, oh, well, that's it. Let's just take it in. And come to find out, got snookered.
Right.
See?
Okay.
Now, I don't know if they taught you that. But
yeah, exactly, but yeah, I look up VINs all the time, but maybe not that route, so I learned something today.
Go to the parts department, guys, and make sure that it's called the exterior, you know, parts,
mm-hmm.
and hardware.
Okay.
The door handle and the mirror housing are the hardware. That's a different category than the bumpers and the side cap molding and that. It's one tone, two tone. Toyota. Okay.
So I got to look up this paint code too then, K95.
Yeah, K95 and 760. You'll see the difference between the two.
Okay.
And the VIN is on a 760 single tone, or the VIN is a 760 single tone, but the vehicle it's on is a K95.
Got it.
You cannot, because it comes out of the factory that way, and there's only one VIN. There's only one. It don't work that like that. So, anyway.
All right.
There you have it.
Got it. Well, it's nice meeting you, sir.
Nice meeting you. Monday or Tuesday, you should be expecting a video coming in.
Okay, perfect.
Okay.
Perfect. I probably won't be back to work until... Actually, Tuesday. I'll be back on Tuesday, so
Tuesday?
That'll be perfect.
I'll wrap it up Monday and have it in your inbox.
Sounds good.
The only thing is, though, is that I filmed somebody ordering parts over the phone. The guy that I filmed, I got his permission to film, but the person that's on the phone, I didn't. Is that wiretapping?
This state's a two-party consent state, so technically you're supposed to get consent, but... It's a little wishy-washy when it's over the phone.
But he's on the job and it's just giving out a part number.
I wouldn't worry about it then.
If he doesn't press charges, right?
No, there's nothing incriminating that guy, so.
Right.
Nah, it's fine.
Okay, so anyway, I'll send it in.
All right, perfect.
You'll get it about Monday or so.
All right. Sounds good. You have a good night, sir.
Okay, you too.
I'm going to get to work.
Very proud that my first foray into the acting world is for Cousins Subs. I'm plugging that because every time I say Twisted Subs, I get another one. And so Twisted Subs are really good. I love Twisted Subs. Twisted Subs have reinvented the hairy monster that I am into a more refined and more focused human being. I love Twisted Subs. That's like 8 now, right? Yeah? Okay, somewhere in there. I should be counting. If I don't want to be shorted on my subs.
You need to know the color of the door handle outside.
Yeah.
And you need to know the trim.
Color. Yeah. And the bumper cover.
And what color?
Bumper.
Bumper cover.
And the mirror.
Mirror color.
Door handle, bumper, trim, mirror.
Downtown Toyota. Hey, I gotta find out what original colors were on this Toyota RAV4. The last 8? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, we got X7113044. And what I need to know is what the door handles came out factory stock color, the trim inside the cab color, the outside mirror color, dark turquoise. K95 on the handle. Okay, dark turquoise. Could you do me a favor? Could you actually fax me all that? Let me get back with you on the fax number. And who am I talking to?
Tom.
Okay, and you're at Toyota Parts?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, then I'll call you back, Tom, with the fax number.
Okay.
And then we can fax all that information. That's the outside mirrors, the door handle colors, and the inside trim color when it was factory done, okay? Could we do that, please?
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, thank you. Bye. Hey Don, Steve here at Bogles. Hey, can I get your fax number, please? I am having something from Toyota come over. Yeah, I'm ready. 235-5823. Okay, thank you, Don. Okay, bye. T-Bear Bulldog Auto, Gina. I got that fax number. It's actually would be, I don't know how your fax machine works. 509-235-5823. And it's going to Napa Fax and Attention Bulbas. Bye. Okay, and then you'll have the VIN number on the contract on the paperwork too. Yeah, attach that on there, the VIN number and all that stuff too. Okay. All right. Thank you. Bye. So the dealership will fax me over a copy of everything that originally came on that RAV4.
Right.
With that VIN number.
Okay.
What the factory colors were supposed to be for trim, outside trim, interior trim, all that from the factory.
Okay.
And what it is.
Now, there's that down there on the floor. Okay, you got the toilet panels. One's pearl, blue pearl. Anyway, Rockstar pearl. And the other one's Mystic Teal. All
yeah, right. The Mystic Teal is what came on that, right? What they said.
Right.
That was original off that VIN number.
I'm not a monkey. All right. I'm a cousin to the Yeti. I'm a Sasquatch. I'm educated. I'm intelligent. I'm articulate. I speak several languages. As говоришь с Bulgarski, je suis un peu français, so I speak Espanol. I've practiced opera for many years. I mean, what more do you want?
I'm sorry, can we stop? I don't want to talk anymore right now.
You get tired of staring at the same tree day after day. It's kind of like being in a cubicle. Well, not really like being in a cubicle.
I'm a refined being. I'm self-aware. I have feelings and emotions. And it really hurts those feelings when I have to watch another piece of cinematic crap. Some guy going, and the women go, and the guys go, kill it. And then it gets killed. But you get my point, okay?
I'm a Sasquatch.
All right, first thing you gotta do is we gotta prep this. You know, we gotta get the rough shine off of this deal, okay? Except the new paint. Right.
Okay. Yeah.
You gotta rough it up, get it roughed up. We're using a non-sandable primer. You don't have to, you just shoot it. Let it set up for a little bit and go over it with the one stage paint that we got.
Yeah.
Get all the high spots out. Primer. Make sure it's hooked up good.
shake it up. Really shake it up. Okay. When you're ready, you gotta put your primer on. You don't wanna really just put it on. You just wanna basically throw a tack coat out there. Just a tack coat, okay? Just a tack coat. You don't have to be perfect. Just something. Begin with, okay? Just a tack coat.
Okay.
Okay, let that set for a little bit. What do we got today? It's drying pretty good, drying pretty fast. Okay, so now you want to put a good even coat. Hey, good. So you just want to put a good even coat on all the way through. Nice. You want to basically follow over in one step here, follow through. You know, can't rush it too much. You don't want to go too close to it, or you don't.
This is where I do my artwork. Where you see one of these, this is by yours truly. Spent about 8 months on it. And I named it after a place that I hope to go someday in Paris, France. So this one's L'Arc de Triomphe, okay? And then my favorite, though, is right over there. Spent about 12 and a half months on that one. And that one is dirt. Dirt. Rock. So if cousins... So sandwiches, you know, if they want to, you know, because this would look, don't you think this would look very good in the middle of an eatery? This to me says, I'm hungry. Feed me. Now, please. That's what this says to me. And that's my art.
I don't want to go too far away or you won't get an even coat.
Okay.
Kathleen T. Zellner is evidently reported spending $600,000 so far in Stephen Avery's appeals. And what it is that she has the green RAV4 and the blue RAV4, the same RAV4. Because they're supposed to be chameleon colors, you see. But Toyota came out with both of them on separate vehicles, and for some reason they produce a vehicle that gets confused with another vehicle coat, paint coat. You see. So for the price of $21 a can, two cans, $42 and change, $45, you know, and paying you to do this, $40. Comes out to be $95. $100 bill plus lunch. We're talking about $120 so far. So we're gonna do for $120 what Kathleen's owner can't do for $600,000. You know? It doesn't matter which side does what. Want me to hold that?
Hang on.
Okay.
They will race him.
Just nothing.
Free it out. Jason. Spotlights.
Yeah. Okay.
A stage one paint, you know, just a good cover lacquer, you know, acrylic. And I'm sorry about that. It's acrylic enamel base. Yeah. One shot deal.
Yeah.
So according to the light,
really shake it up good.
According to light conditions and weather conditions, it's supposed to change color.
Yep.
So we're gonna find out.
Okay, this is just basically the same principle as when you set up the primer.
Mm-hmm.
You wanna start with the tack coat first, okay?
Got it.
Oh, so you know the Patterson Bigfoot? Yeah, that's Sasquatch's. That was my Uncle Fred. Yeah, that was my. I can do it. I can do the walk. You want to see it? Hold on. Thank you very much. There you go.
Now, this right here, doesn't say anything about what the color is on the top, does it?
You're supposed to keep the top on it. So that way you know which,
yeah.
Just hit a little bit of that on that right there and it'll tell you what color it is.
Yeah. Well, the number they didn't write.
Just spray a little bit right there and see what color you got coming out of there.
Yeah, okay.
Yep, that's the color you got.
Yep. Okay, so this here is
Mystic. Now that's Royal Sapphire Pearl.
Yeah, okay. It's still in the can. It's a B5521600 that's been pre-filled by Napa.
Yeah.
Paint store.
Yeah.
Okay. Now that tack coat's about ready to go here. It's set there for a while. So now, like I said, we got to even stay even. They didn't really give you the right command to do an even job. You know, you need to spray nozzle, the spray nozzle, the spray nozzle. Hopefully, we can do something. Thank you.
follow back down, even strokes, not too close, not too far away. Okay, now it's really laying in there nice and perfect. Really laying in there. Okay, you gotta come get that right there on that side. Yeah. Yeah, so there is one coat. That's all you're gonna do.
Just one coat. That's all you have to do.
Alright. There we go. Now let that set.
We gotta let that set for a while.
About how long?
Probably a good hour.
Okay.
And then it'll set up. It'll the pigments it'll start setting up and getting the true color. All this stuff will start blending on drying time.
Okay, so in about an hour?
About an hour.
And then we'll do this side.
We'll do the other side.
Okay. So. Well, sign off. Steve Bogle. Later.
All you ladies out there, I'm single. Now, I know what you're thinking, okay? But all this can be removed, all right? Waxing, shaving, underneath all this fur you've got. The six-pack abs and a chest of Adonis. I have a sweet hookup. All right, you can go to Cousin Subs because I got a lifetime membership thing going on there where whatever I want, they just give it to me, you know. That's pretty nice, actually. So, you can find me on the want ads under LLOKINN Sasquatch. That's my handle. And, hit me up. And, we'll have a good time.
Yeah, you're on.
All right, so, we got the first half of the other color done. Mm-hmm. Now we're starting the procedure on the second half of the other color.
All right.
And so now what we do the same thing is we spray just a little tack coat on this thing. This is just a tack coat.
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of tack it. Okay, so now we're just going to sit for a little bit. Kind of air dry for a little bit.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Let that dry. It is 6 feet three, deep jewel green. That's what that is.
Everybody, thank you for tuning in. I'm Carol Sherwood, and this is Back to the Beginning in the Stephen Avery case. If you have seen Making a Murderer on Netflix, then you'll be familiar with the case. I just want to let you know that we, you, me, us, collectively, are going to debunk the Stephen Avery case.
Look like an IG model, walk with a waddle, body shaped like a Coke bottle, put stay on full throttle, love it when I swallow.
It was all about getting Stephen in prison. Forever. Forever. If Wisconsin had the death penalty, I promise you, they would have sentenced him to the death penalty.
Take it, baby, baby, yeah. Take it, take it, love it, love it. Come here, boy, 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 boy. Come here, boy, 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 boy.
Some people have very strong feelings on the other side of things. I will tell you that for the evidence that was presented in court for this trial, on the face, on the surface, he looks guilty. They found blood in the car of Stephen's blood. They found Teresa's blood. They found DNA.
I tell all my numbers, cut the check. Bust it out, turn your goofy dog, pow. I'ma do splits on it, yeah, splits on it. I'm a bad bitch, I'ma throw fits on it. I'ma bust it open, I'ma go stupid. You tryna sign me?
They found several pieces of evidence that were on his property. The key to the car was, they found in the bedroom. The RAV4 was found on Avery property.
I set my face bomb, abs tight, racks stuck up, shack height, jury on me, flashlight. I've been listening since last night. With that good, good, make you wanna act right. Broke boys don't deserve no kitty.
I know that's right.
Big bag pussy, not the Bentley band. Take a man.
I will tell you, it was very well orchestrated. It seemed like it was really done kind of in a hurry, but that's okay. I'm not worried about the timing of it. It really boils down to the fact that it happened. It happened, and we collectively as a country, the United States of America, we let this happen. We let this case go through the courts and convict these two men, one of who was a 16-year-old mentally challenged youth. And we've convicted both of them. We have, all of us have, because no one stood up and said, we're not gonna let this happen. We're not gonna let it happen. And because people on the state side, several of the players on the state side, chose not to turn over all of the evidence. And they chose not to be forthright. And they chose to deceive. So we're going to look at quite a few items. We're going to look at all the items of evidence that were presented, but we're also going to look at some things that didn't get dug into that definitely needed to be dug into. So there's plenty of information. There have been years go by, lots of online sleuthers. Kudos to them for doing the research they've done and uncovering so many inconsistencies in this case. And it's just painful to know that these two men sit in prison and have for almost 18 years and no one cares. No one in authority cares. No one cares to take it on and do the right thing.
Into the thick of it. Into the thick of it. Into the thick of it.
Oh, I know I may be young, but I've got feelings too.
Let's debunk the Stephen Avery case, and to do that, we're gonna go back to the beginning.
Because I call him Carol Baskins. Body, yaddy, 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 yaddy,
yaddy, yaddy, yaddy. Thank you for joining me, Carol Sherwood, and the Back to the Beginning Mod Podcast for Stephen Avery. And the mod to the pod is music to go with your video podcast. So I made that up, Mod Podcast. So this theme is bad boys.
What's your sign?
What it is?
I'm a Cancer.
That's right.
Body built
like wood,
like a dancer.
Okay.
Shake that ass.
Shake it, shake it.
Throw the camera.
Clap, clap.
If he a dirty bitch, then throw him in a hamper.
Bad boys, bad boys. What you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you? Yeah.
The party began.
Hi, everybody. This is Carol Sherwood. Welcome to Stephen Avery, Back to the Beginning. We are going to talk about the RAV4, specifically the color of the RAV4. Before you jump ship or change channels, hang with me for just a minute. We're not going to debate whether or not the car was green or blue. That's been done for years. What we're going to do is take a look at why there's been such a debate and maybe what's behind so much of the debate and why the color seemed to be such a focus in the beginning of this investigation and carried all the way into the trial from 2005 until 2007. That's a long time to argue about whether a car is green or blue or greeny bluey or bluey greeny or teal. So let's dig right in. All right. So Teresa Halbach drove a 1999 RAV4 four-wheel drive, and the VIN number on that car is
give me more.
information, so I'm just sharing with you the VIN, JT3HP10B5X711344. I memorized it. Are you impressed? That tells you how many times I've read that VIN. So in my research, I learned more about VIN numbers and car color codes than I've ever known or wanted to know in my life. But they're both very significant in this case. Here's partially why.
Got my letter with Chicago. Got my letter with Chicago.
That's what Millie said.
Got my letter with Chicago.
He love when I clap for him. Moving my ass in these platforms.
If you've known me longer than 5 seconds, you should know that I am a two-rabber. I believe there were two Ravs.
Fuck it up real quick. Okay.
Bend, snap, pop, make it high. Let me see you try. Hunnits on the floor, put it low. Bottle saying whoa. Dougie and I'm fresh, yeah, I'm fresh. Fresher than the rest. Bop to hit my shit, yeah, I'm lit. Shake it for the tip.
I cannot give you a reason why there were two Ravs. I can speculate, and I will, but not right now.
Just came out of the motherfucking old school. Got my Mac notebook with the Pro Tools. That bitches ain't ready for Nicki Lewinsky. Bad whoop, flyer than a frisbee.
The car really is teal. No doubt about it. When you learn the VIN number and you backtrace the VIN number, the VIN itself does not have the color code in it. But you can use the VIN color for your car, my car, anybody's car. Call the manufacturer dealerships, call a Toyota dealership, and you will find that if you give them the VIN number, they are able to look up the car's color code. Body shops, dealerships, all of those people who, if something happens to a vehicle and they've got to do body work on it, they have to be able to go back to the manufacturer's color codes so they order the correct paint. That's logical. That makes sense to me. Okay. So that's why when I called two different Toyota dealerships plus Toyota Corporate, no, I didn't call Japan. I just called Plano because there is a Toyota Corporation in Plano. I don't know how to speak Japanese.
Bow, bow, bow. Give it to me, daddy. That's what she keeps screaming. Give it to me, daddy. She love the way I beat it.
They confirmed from my giving them the VIN number that the color code that belongs to Teresa Halbach's vehicle, that VIN number, is 760 Mystic Teal Mica. That's been known for a long, long time. Nobody has disputed that that car is called Mystic Teal Mica. People have argued, debated, had knockdown, drag out fights online. You should see some of the social media posts. It's insanity about people arguing over the color. It's teal. That's it. Teal. It's gonna look more green. And it's gonna look more blue depending on the lighting that it's in or the camera settings. So, whoop-de-doo. Here's where it gets a little bit interesting.
You got pretty women honking at you all day long?
I wasn't a woman.
Oh.
That was dying.
You missed it. You're supposed to play along. Oh yeah. But the camera couldn't tell.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Got this egg along here to get. Okay. Be back in about what? An hour?
No, we can do the other thing now.
Okay. Well, see, there's controversy about the actual color, you know, and because her car was reported as dark green, and then it ended up being blue. You know?
Oh, yeah. That's,
on the warrant was blue.
Man, it's pouring down rain. This is really screwing up my day.
Yeah. Thing about it is that Teresa had a single tone 760, but K95 color code K95 is 760 Mystic Teal Mica, and this A13 silver gray silver metallic. Well, she didn't have gray silver metallic, but the vehicle that they got from the salvage yard has a silver gray metallic. So if the paint doesn't get it, then the two-tone will. Oh, there you go. You said you work in a paint shop or someplace for Caterpillar or whatever?
International Harvester.
Oh, yeah, okay. What'd you do?
I rebuilt engines and paint tractors and paint booths and everything else on that.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Anyway, they can... mess with the paint job, but it's the catalytic that gets them. Side moldings and stuff.
Yep.
We need to re-hit that because there's a little bit of overspray. There's a little bit of overspray. See?
Yeah, okay. Hold that.
That's the best we can do.
Look, I don't think they pay attention to stuff like that, okay? She was in a nurse. She was stressed out, calling in her daughter, worried about her daughter. What the closest color? How's she going to say, oh, exact. It's Mystic Teal, Micah something something. No, no, no. She's not Richard Boyd.
Downtown Toyota.
And that's why they didn't put it on the right. records probably and the that news, way. Honestly, blue.
Good evening. We will have that story in just a moment. First, we have some breaking news from Calumet County.
To be honest with you, the news did say this is not
the vehicle, but it is similar, being
right. body shape is what, you know, right. and that's what they were talking about.
Thank you for calling Larry H. Miller Dealership. Due to COVID-19, the sales operations will be closed until April 8th. Our service and parts operations remain open to service our customers. Please press 1 to be connected to the service department. Please press 2 to be connected to the parts department. We appreciate your patience and understanding during this difficult.
But you really have to pay attention to that.
Sheriff Jerry Poggle called us in the last 2 hours for our help in finding a missing 25-year-old Hilbert woman. He's calling her disappearance suspicious. Our Jason Zimmerman live in our newsroom now with all the details. Jason?
I'm not sure where I took this screenshot from. Somebody must have posted this Twitter, Reddit, Facebook maybe.
Richard Boyd. Bill,
25-year-old Teresa Marie Halbach was last seen Monday afternoon. This is a picture of Teresa. She was last seen Monday afternoon in Manitowoc.
Is this a Toyota what?
RAV4.
RAV4?
Her close friends tell us tonight no one has heard from her, which is very unusual.
Hey, Tom. Steve here at Bogle's Auto Repair in Cheney.
She also has not showed up for work or her home.
Hey, I got to find out what original colors were on this Toyota RAV4.
Friends say they've tried calling her cell phone, but her voicemail box is full.
Let me see here. The last 8? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Teresa Halbach is 5'6", about 135 pounds. She has light brown hair and brown eyes.
Okay, we got X7113044.
She was last seen wearing blue jeans, a white button-down shirt, and a summer jacket.
And what I need to know is what the door handles came out factory stock color.
The Calumet County... Sheriff says she was driving a 1999 dark green Toyota RAV4 like this one, license plate SWH582. Again, this is 25-year-old Teresa Marie Halbach from Hilbert.
Dark turquoise.
She was last seen Monday.
K95, so it shows.
Is it Toyota VIN decoder? And this is this when you. When you put this in, you do see that the paint code color 760.
The Calumet County Sheriff is calling her disappearance suspicious.
K95 on the handle.
Which is Mystic Teal Mica. It's not blue or green. It's actually Mystic Teal Mica.
If you've seen Teresa, please call the Calumet County Sheriff's Department.
Yeah. Okay, dark turquoise.
But they didn't put that out there because...
Reporting from the newsroom, Jason Zimmerman, Action 2 News.
I don't know if everybody would understand what a Mystic Teal Mica car might look like.
Yeah, exactly.
Side of a joking way. He does get a little carried away attacking others, but he is constantly on my case.
Yeah.
off this rap situation.
If you like audiobooks or audio shows, check out a free trial of Audible. Just click the link in the description.
Welcome to Mindshock True Crime. You are listening to the Stephen Avery series. This is part 15, The RAV4, part 3. I'm your host, Bruce McGuire.
And Johnny Mills.
And today we're going over even more oddities regarding Teresa Halbach's supposed RAV4 that was found on Avery's salvage yard and all of the bizarre circumstances surrounding that, including one of the biggest mind shocks of the case yet. Was it really found by Pam of God? And what evidence exists for it being found earlier by different individuals who actually reported it? What do you think about that, Johnny?
Yeah, that's sketchy.
Yeah, but before we get to that, we have plenty of more to go over and things that just simply don't add up in this case, of which there are many. If you like the podcast, you can donate to our PayPal. Just check the link in the description. Make sure to subscribe to the channel. Hit the bell for notifications. If you like the podcast, hit the like button. Feel free to share it across social media platforms. And you can check us out on Facebook, Twitter, Reddit, and Patreon. And patrons do get priority in case and subject requests for the podcast. All right, so let's dive into it. So there's a lot of sketchy aspects to this case. We discussed in the previous few episodes whether or not Teresa's RAV4 was mystic teal, forest green, like blue, green, red, whatever. You know, Ken Kratz actually went down the gauntlet and named it almost every single color there is just to cover the spectrum. But what some people actually believe that even photographs admitted into evidence were photoshopped, and random photographs were photoshopped throughout this entire thing. So is the most famous photograph of Teresa Halbach's RAV4, is that photoshopped? I mean, some people point to the weird reflections, the there appears to be some kind of blur at her feet. I mean, what do you think about all this? These are supposedly this is a professional photographer working for a professional photography business, which we touched upon this on who took this picture, what the associations were, and coincidental things with the timeline with the business just being shut down and the timeline of the trial and all this weirdness. But real quick, let's look at the picture. Does it seem kind of strange?
I'm looking. So you're saying the reflections are kind of weird. Oh yeah, that back yellow green circle, that's supposed to be clouds. That's kind of weird. Yeah, the
reflection. I mean, it does kind of look cloudy that day anyway. It almost looks like, yeah, it's,
yeah, even like the flash, like I think the flash should just be in one point, right? Depending on where it's coming from, not three different flash points.
I mean, I guess it depends on what it's being reflected off of, like how many, what's around that? There looks like there's a car. Is there a car right behind the person taking the photograph? Are there other reflective surfaces to the left and the right? I mean, there shouldn't be, unless it was some kind of staged photograph and they got they brought out like a bunch of reflectors or something.
Yeah, I see the blue circle now, the oval, whatever that is, a little blurriness. So it could be motion blur, but it's kind of like,
how fast did she look like she's moving that fast? Does she look like she's like sprinting out of her car?
Yeah, I mean, roadrunner, she's running real fast.
Yeah, there's a little bit of weird shadow too, like under her camera and at the bottom of her jacket, the back of her jacket. I mean, would it really look like that? I don't know. Like, this whole photo seems strange. Was it manipulated? Some people say, oh look, it was this color and this, but are we taking on blind faith that this whole Teresa Halbach situation, not that she wasn't a real person, I mean, people have done their research, they found photographs of her in school and all these things, she was definitely a real person. You know, obviously that was one of the most insane, preposterous, I mean, although if she was a made-up person, I mean, if that's what the truth is, that's what it is. I mean, we're not going to appeal to incredulity and fallacies, but it appears there's plenty of evidence to corroborate she was indeed a real person.
All right, so let's go on to page 3. This is some crazy shit. And I know Casey has already said this in one of her videos, but I'm going to have to say it again. What the fuck? It says right here on page 3 of this. Manitowoc County Sheriff's Office Summary. Evidence seized. Toyota, RAV4, dark green, utility. On November 3rd. Evidence seized on November 3rd. Teresa's car. What is that about?
Good evening. I'm Christiane Omanpo, and tonight we are excited to—
Thank you for joining us for our joint interview here on CNN. I'm Nancy Grace. Tonight, we have Stephen Avery. He is one guilty son of a bitch.
Nancy, generally I don't like to make outlandish assumptions before actually conducting the interview.
Okay, well, you know what, Christy? Can I call you Christy?
No.
Well, I want to say something, Christy, because usually when someone's guilty, I know it. This ain't my first rodeo. I am a prosecutor. I can tell a lie when I see one.
Right. Welcome, Stephen.
Thank you for having me.
You, sir, are guilty.
My client is innocent.
He is a murderer, and he is a disgusting human being. You chopped up that young woman, and you set her on fire. What do you have to say for yourself, Stephen?
I didn't do it. I'm innocent.
Innocent? Oh, innocent as a prom queen with her ankles up around her ears. Police!
Nancy!
I don't understand any of this.
I have an idea. How about I ask questions first, and then after I'm finished, you can have a go.
All right. All right, it is your show. Take it away.
Exactly. Thank you.
I'll just do it better, but it's your turn.
Okay. Stephen, I understand that you have found some evidence that undisputably proves your innocence.
Yeah, you know, yeah. After tonight, there won't be any doubt as to his innocence. We actually—
You sliced up that poor girl. You threw her in a burn pit outside of your trailer and you burned her bones. Guilty! Guilty!
Nancy!
Just let him argue. Let him fight.
Let's let him speak. How about that?
Jolly Rancher.
Stephen, can you please share with us the evidence that was found that proves your innocence?
Yeah. Tonight, Mrs. Amanpour, we are excited to announce Teresa Halbach has been found alive.
What a revelation! Teresa, welcome.
Thank you. I just want to say, everybody, I am so sorry about all this confusion. I went on a trip to Cabo, took some terrible shrooms. Next thing I know, I end up in a Mexican prison. Thank God I finally got out with the help of some guy named, El Chapo. Yeah. Sean Penn was there, too. He gave me this perm. Oh, I've had my keys the whole time.
I guess I didn't do it.
Absolutely incredible. Nancy, what do you have to say now?
You need to look forward, please. Look at the camera.
His sweat was on those keys. He is guilty. Guilty as hell.
I'm hungry. Just hold it. Okay, we'll stop. We'll get lunch.
Good night.
Good night.
Dang, did it?
So,
that right here, matchup between two photographs. One for Inslee Harbaugh, the other one for Teresa St. Jean tomorrow. Well, guess what turns out to look like? Put it all together. Gnarly. Is that gnarly or what? That's not Christian Harbaugh. Look at that. The eyes are mad, the teeth are mad, the nose is coming. Fuck. For the ears. Okay. Anyways. There we have it, folks. Now, let's get some facial recognition going here. Let's nail this bitch down, people. That's what happens when we start cooperating. Oh, I'll be saying this all the hell fucking long. So finally, Brittany Woodward. Yeah. Over in Megan Murder Gossip Group. Yep.
Got back to me.
Well, that's a damn good fucking match, people. That's close, if not spot dead on. It's enough. There's probable cause to believe that Teresa Marie Harbaugh, that Teresa St. Jean Crockett, and Trump British Columbia, and that Teresa Marie Harbaugh is not dead. Thank you.
guys. Okay, so right now, I guess I'm going to do my little comeback. It's been a minute since I've made a video, but I've been having a lot of people ask me what I think about Making a Murderer 2, and I guess I just have had a lot to say, but I have been leaving comments on Twitter and Facebook, and not really seriously thinking of doing a video until people just really started asking me, what do I think, what do I think, what do I think? And so something that triggered me a couple of weeks ago, whenever it was that Catherine Zellner did her Twitter Q&A, was one of the questions she was asked about was the date planner, like something about what does she think about the date planner and how it's involved. Her response is actually what triggered me to seriously consider making a video. Because I was so concerned with her answer that because I couldn't believe that either she maybe had missed it or she ruled it out and we don't know why or how, but it's still a very big issue for me. So I wanted to, let me just read what she wrote. She said, the date planner is an independent issue from the murder of Miss Halbach. It was no. Likely be connected to moving the RAV4 and accessing its contents. All of Ms. Halbach's paperwork was removed from the RAV4 before it was found.
not dead. Let's see. Stephen Avery and Brendan Dassey are innocent. They didn't kill Teresa, but Teresa's still dead anyway. How did that fucking work?
So we got Teresa's new phone records, and we noticed that Denise Coakley has talked to Teresa at around 11:30 on the 31st and said, I'd like to set up an appointment with you on Tuesday, November the 1st at noon. And Denise said, when I talked to Teresa, she said, oh, I'm driving. Let me pull over and jot this down. So Teresa pulls over and she jots down Denise noon on November 1st. Okay, so she's in her car. Then we discover that Steve Speckman calls Teresa just about an hour after Denise's call. Okay, so it's around 12:45. And he tells her that he's got a couple vehicles he wants her to photograph. So Teresa jots down Steve and Sheboygan and then the vehicles and his phone number, and he confirms that she's driving in her car. It's now 12:45, okay? And so just reconstructing the time frame in which she arrived at her next appointment. There isn't time for her to have gone all the way back to her house with the day planner, left it at her house, and then left again. It's the schedule's too tight for her to arrive at Schmidt's. Scott Blaydorn said that he found the day planner at Teresa Halbach's residence and that it was from the Outlook program on the computer. And it was before Teresa wrote on it when she was out on the road talking to Denise Coakley and Speckman and drove to Schmidt's. So she's at the Schmidt's house and then she goes to the Zippers and then she goes on to the Avery's. Her day planner is in the car with her because she never goes back home. There isn't time. So, how does Ryan Hillegas get this piece of paper unless he has accessed Teresa's car after she's been to the Avery's?
So, some of this is going to be in response to some of the things he's constantly messaging me about and stuff like that. So here's the picture, and all of these pictures, by the way, they're none of them have been edited. They all come, to my knowledge, they all come from StephenAveryCase.org, every single one of them. So this picture we've all seen now.
you look back at some of the most infamous serial killers to ever grace the streets of America. Who do you have? You have Ted Bundy, you have Son of Sam, Jeffrey Dahmer, the Zodiac Killer, the Green something killer, sorry. But these are famous people that had big press releases, and some of them were after them for a long time. Do you realize that not one of them ever had a press conference that you could not continue to listen to? That's a fucking problem. So before you even get into really what I found, let me take a step back and explain gaslighting. What is gaslighting? Gaslighting is when somebody's trying to convince you of something that they say you did that you never did. It's kind of like making you lose your mind. So if I say to my husband, you cheated on me, he's going to say, no, I didn't. And I'm going to say, yes, you did. And you did it this time, on this date, with this person, and you were in this parking lot. And he's going to say, you're fucking out of your mind. And then I'm going to convince him over and over and over that this is what he did and this is how he did it. Eventually, it's going to break him down to the point where he's going to say, did I do it? Maybe I did do it. And he's going to question his own sanity. That's gaslighting. The cops did this to Brandon on November 6th and on March 1st. Now, the other catch of gaslighting is that with gaslighting, you know what you're telling somebody, so you can even convince yourself over and over that they cheated at this time. What I found in a video is, and you guys can watch it, it's Praxis trusting this. Not once did he ever look down at a paper to know what he was saying. Are you gonna fucking tell me that this guy sat there all night on March 1st and studied every single thing that Brandon said? Get the fuck out of here. No, he didn't. He's not even that intelligent. So, Brandon's confession wasn't until March 1st. And the press release was March 2nd. And Kratz also made it a point to say numerous times about sweat and how everything is sweat. Guys, give me a fucking break. There is no way in hell that he knew every single fucking detail of what Brandon said, unless, and a big unless, he was the one feeding Brandon, or the cops, was feeding Brandon exactly what was meant to be said. No defending gaslighting. And that's what I came to this afternoon, that, you know, this whole entire case from A to Z has been a butt fuck of so many different minds, or I should say a mind fuck of so many different people. You know, let me also stress the fact, Brandon is a special ed kid. I have autistic child. I know what that's like. I could probably convince my son, who is also a gifted student and a high IQ, I could probably convince him that he killed Kennedy if I tried hard enough. That's exactly what happened to Brandon. And to nail it in the coffin, what does Kratz do? He blows his load, basically, to the entire fucking public. That's insane. Nobody else has ever done that in the history of serial killers or murders. I mean, in this country, we are innocent until proven guilty. Who the fuck are you to give a press release like that? Not even just, okay, we arrested somebody. A fucking press release like that, one day after you get a confession? Really? And all these people get fucking promoted? I'm sorry, but that's just fucking insane to me. So, I'll have more videos coming, but this was my first, and I hope you enjoyed it, and if you didn't, oh well.
Hello. I'm making this video today to point out a few things about the November 6th interview of Brendan Dassey. First off, this is all happening one day after the RAV4 has been discovered. At this point in time, they couldn't have possibly had any evidence that pointed to Brendan to justify the interrogation. In fact, we now know that they never found any trace of Brendan in the RAV4 or in Steven's trailer. But Deputy O'Neill couldn't have known that at the time. Nor did he have any evidence pointing to Brendan at the time. Deputy O'Neill is a sheriff with the Marinette County Sheriff's Department who pulled over Brendan with his brother Blaine while they were on their way to get some photos for the Crivitz cabin. I listened to this interview for the first 20 minutes and it seemed mostly normal. Just law enforcement asking normal questions in pursuit of a missing persons investigation. However, around the 20-minute mark, that all changes, and Deputy O'Neill begins telling Brendan what happened. His first clip is mostly harmless.
That girl taking that picture. You're not the boss, it's a beautiful day, it's daylight, everybody sees it. You do too. Do you remember seeing that girl standing there taking a picture?
Brandon, come on.
You do know, don't you?
Now that's no big deal. I think we can all agree that Teresa was there, whether you believe she left or not. But what this does show is that the deputy is beginning to tell Brendan what to say. And then 30 seconds later, he says this.
It's either yes or no. I mean, I'm not putting nothing in your mind. You tell me if you remember that girl standing there taking a picture.
Okay, well that's good, right? At this point, O'Neill becomes very aggressive and begins asking Brendan about when he got off the bus. O'Neill then asks Brendan if he saw Teresa, to which Brendan responds yes, he saw her taking pictures of a van.
What happened to that girl? She didn't leave. What happened to that girl?
She stayed there 5 minutes and then she left.
Oh, that's what you're being told to say.
Brendan.
What happened to that girl?
Brandon. What happened to the girl, Brandon?
Why don't
what happened to the girl?
No, that's all I know.
So you got off the bus, you walked on the driveway. She's still there, right? You see her, don't you?
Yeah.
Who else is out with you?
When I listen to that, and I hear Brendan ask, do you guys think he did it? It's because Brendan's beginning to realize that their questions are suggesting that he knows his Uncle Steven did something to Teresa. I believe upon realizing this, he asks the question out of sheer shock. 40 seconds later, O'Neill asks Brendan about the question.
Question, Brendan. You think he did it? No, you just asked me that question. Why would you ask me that? Did what?
that he raped her? Did she go into his house, Brandon?
Maybe it's because a traffic stop turned into an interrogation, and 25 minutes in, Brendan just feels like he's being attacked. He's scared and confused, and he really doesn't believe his Uncle Stephen was involved. And he also notices that O'Neill is becoming very agitated, so he starts guessing. He remembers the rape that his Uncle Stephen was accused of before. If law enforcement can frame his Uncle Stephen then, he probably figures if he says that, O'Neill will finally leave him alone. It's pretty clear in the way that Brendan phrases all of his responses as a question, that he's grasping at straws and hoping that O'Neill will leave him alone. A bit later, Brendan says that Teresa left the property, and this is O'Neill's response.
Concerned. Did something happen that shouldn't have happened? Well, why are you lying to me about that?
Accusations of lying with no evidence on Brendan? Dirty pool.
Don't worry about that. That truck did not leave that place. It did not go out the driveway and take a left.
Once again, O'Neill tells Brendan she didn't leave. And then he follows with this a short time later.
And nobody's saying that Stephen did this, okay? Nobody's saying that.
What? Are you freaking kidding me, O'Neill? You've constantly been asking whether or not she went inside Stephen's trailer, and you've said several times that she never left there. 2 + 2 = 4, Chief.
Is that girl alive, Brown?
No, she is.
Is she? Yeah, you do know, Brown. Are you involved in this?
She's just constantly badgering, or calling him a liar, or just completely dismissing his words. But Brendan still has sympathy for his Uncle Stephen. I love that Brendan brings this up. If you've wrongfully convicted a man once, shouldn't you possibly take a little extra care to make sure you don't repeat that mistake? Or at least give the appearance of fair play? Apparently not. The fact that this is all happening on November 6th, one day after the RAV4 was found, really reminds me of the way that they reported Stephen Avery as a murder suspect 154 minutes after Teresa Hallback was reported missing. I will leave a link to Sean Atwood's video down below, by the way, so that you can check that out. Meanwhile, let's check in with O'Neill.
Where'd they go? She didn't leave. Brandon, she didn't leave.
So we're going to listen to this stuff on Common Sense Central called Rebutting America. I'm going to go through each episode. I'm going to rebut.
Well, it's on and on. Here they come. Up the road. After 18 years.
Making a Murderer is a national obsession. A riveting, visually stunning masterpiece of documentary filmmaking. But it's also one of the more slanted, one-sided pieces of storytelling in recent memory, establishing its narrative that an innocent man was twice framed within the very first 2 minutes of the series.
We knew he was innocent. We knew he was innocent.
Law enforcement despised Stephen Avery. Stephen Avery was a shining example of their inadequacies, their misconduct.
It was like the same old Steve was bad. He was happy, he was smiling. I did tell him, be careful.
Okay, folks, so now I'd like to get into a
an area that's very close to my heart. Now, I spent the majority of my life training for a career in criminal justice. I originally wanted to be a criminal law attorney. And, you know, circumstances, life happens, and I wound up not going to law school. But that doesn't take away from my original passion, which is law, more specifically criminal law, more specifically homicide. And I did train for a while there to be a homicide detective. I have a criminal justice degree with a focus on forensic analysis. And, you know, so this was a very big deal to me.
Hello, John Applebee. This is my captain from London. This is the first in my Making the Murder question series. The question I received was, what do I actually think happened to Peter Halbach? Usually when there's a murder, it's committed by someone they know, ex-boyfriend, family member. So I would put ex-boyfriend at the top of my suspect list. According to a co-worker, he was allegedly stalking another co-worker at his place of employment, which was a nurse. If he was stalking Teresa, then perhaps Teresa had found a new love interest. Maybe he committed a crime of passion, which is quite common. We also have the Zipper theory, whereby supposedly Zipper was the last stop. Cell phone records show things that Adolf Kratz said. She may have been at Zipper's. Zipper may have suspected her for trespassing and shot and killed her, thinking she was a trespasser. So, they're my two main suspects. Still got the German suspect on the list, he's not completely off yet. He's threatened to sue me and he's threatened some other people online. His ex-wife has completely changed her tune about what she said originally that was put on the internet. We know that people who completely flip-flop, like Stephen Avery's ex, flip-flop and said he was guilty. To me, that arouses more suspicion, so I'm still
Stephen Avery? Yeah, roll up. You're out of there. By order of Sheriff James. Gary?
Yeah.
Tagle. And investigator Wendy Baldwin. When they flew over the Avery Savage Yard on the 4th of November 2005 and took an aerial photograph, which proves that Chris Halbach's 1999 Toyota RAV4 was not where Pam Strom found it. Also, does not show a Subaru or a Skidoo outside of the garage.
We'll sing it for real now. Do this one for the camera. Just heaven and hell for you.
On and on, on and on, it's yeah. On and on, it's yeah. On and on, it's people.
How would you feel if you were charged with a capital offense? The state's case against you lacked all common sense. How would you feel in a court of law full of arrogant pretense? And how would you feel that you could not be saved by truth, the absolute defense? Truth should be the absolute defense. How would you feel left all alone, no attorney or parents, left to the world to tear at your bones, although they lack any evidence? Comes at a cost, at freedom and justice's expense, to lock up two men away for life, though they're innocent. How would you feel that you could not be saved by truth, the absolute defense? All truth should be the absolute defense.
Thank you.
the name of a dead man's teeth. And I write songs about the Avery case, because for me it's a total disgrace to see freedom and justice laid to waste, while so many see but simply turn face. We all know money was at stake, but this was more about saving face. They got it wrong in 85, he was freed by DNA. There was no way they could let it end that way. They cooked up a plan to make him pay. Yes, they convicted old Avery, but there's so many anomalies that simply fall apart under basic scrutiny. And he's shaking that cabinet, and out pops the key. Recreate that, my friend, because I wanna see. Now I'll keep singing, I got dozens more. No matter how much you beg or implore, oh, I'll keep singing till they unlock those doors. Yeah, I'll keep singing, 'cause that's what freedom's for. Oh, I'll keep singing, because that's what freedom's for.
All right, I have one more song left. Thank y'all so much for tuning in. I believe in all of y'all, and you're very beautiful. I hope to see you right back here next Sunday at 7 p.m. Eastern, live from the woods. Thank you. Thank you so much for believing in me. Make sure to check out my merch at www.sacksquatch.com. I'll make a post about it here in a second. And see you next week.
Hello, everybody. You have tuned in to Eric Jose on Making a Murderer on YouTube. I cover virtually any aspect of making a murderer. I go over the evidence, the documents, the photos. So if you like, stay tuned, and in the future I'll have many more videos besides the one you're about to see.
Thank you for watching. Thank you. Good night.
So, obviously we're here to talk about a big announcement, right? Everybody wants to talk about that. So, I have some thoughts, but I want to say something first. I see some people out there who saw it and, you know, were kind of excited by it. I know there's some people out there that, hey, Sila. Hey everybody, by the way. I also saw other people out there that really took an attitude that I, you know, really didn't agree with. And that was that they felt like Zellner was reaching him or something like that. I don't see it. It's, you know, I was making a comparison where it's like, if you're in a football game in the fourth quarter and you're only up by a field goal or you're down by a field goal, you're not going to start pulling your first string, right? No, you're going to push harder. You're going to pull out all the bag. You know, you're going to reach deep into your bag of tricks. And, you know, or you're deep into your, you know, play calling book, as it were, right? And you're going to pull out something unique, special. Well, that's what's happened here. Zellner is just using another tool. He's just trying to, you know, obviously, if somebody can come forward with some type of smoking gun, that makes this whole process a lot more streamlined. So it makes sense. Not only that, we're going to talk about the amount of money and stuff, but we're going to talk about a lot of things. But let's say hi to everybody first. So, hey, everybody in the chat. How's everybody doing? Hey, Jerome. Hey, Linda. How you doing? Hey, Bean. Hello, Larry. I think it's a brilliant thing, and I'm going to explain why.